He's gone.
World was on fire. No one could save me but
you. We're the only ones who matter. And everything they've taken from us, we're going to take back and more.
It's strange what desire will make foolish people do.
The great victory I saw in the flames. All of it was a lie.
What a wicked game you play. Make me feel this way. What a wicked thing to do.
Every one of us is poor and powerless. Yet we can overthrow an empire.
You're in the great game now. And the great game is terrifying.
Order your man to step aside, or there will be violence.
I choose violence.
Never been much of a fighter. Apologies for what you're about to see.
Hey, it's Kim McKay. Game of Thrones just released their season 6 trailer, and it's going to be full of spoilers and awesome surprises and stuff. So we're going to go through and find everything we can out of this tiny little trailer. We'll pull it out, analyze it, and see what we can know. So if you don't want to know any spoilers for season 6, then click out now. Otherwise, we're going to go ahead and break this down. Alright, for this breakdown, we're probably going to go through the different kind of areas, like up in the north and the wall and that kind of storyline, and we'll go through each person throughout the entire thing, instead of just following the chronicle order of this trailer. So we start off with this pan shot of the wall, showing this really dark and grim scenario with only a tiny flicker of light in the background, which is a reflection of what we think is going to happen there this season. Then we have these several quick panning shots to Jon Snow still lying on the ground, being left there by all the Black Brothers. Now, I think the show was trying to throw us off Jon Snow's return by having that dialogue of he's gone, but personally I think us seeing the body is a very big hint that he's going to be revived, because they didn't burn his body at all. Now, from all the scenes we've been seen to get with Davos in this, he seems to be very heavily involved in Jon Snow's storyline. This is probably because he wants to fulfill the last thing that Stannis wanted to do by restoring him to leading the North. Now, this here could be him standing over Jon Snow's body, and then he throws him over the wall, and that's how he becomes resurrected by the White Walkers of Melisandre. I think it's more likely to be Melisandre, but it also could just be like a little grave he set out for the girl or Stannis himself. Now, we have another scene with Davos, and he seems to be in the room where Jon Snow's corpse has been lied down, and his wolf is right there. I can't tell if Ghost is being, like, killed and laying there, or if he's just really still because he's like Ghost, which I really hope he's not dead, because that would be disappointing as hell. Then we have Davos reaching for Longclaw while saying,
I've never been much of a fighter. Apologies for what you're about to see.
To me, I believe that Davos was confronted by Melisandre, who confided in him that she could bring back Jon Snow from the dead, but she needed his help. So he has to go to the room where the Jon Snow's corpse has been, and fight off the Black Brothers so he can free the corpse so that Melisandre can do her voodoo magic on him and bring him back to life. She may also have to have sex with some person. That could have been Davos or someone else, I don't even know, but it seems like that's going to be involved again in the season. Now let's quickly rewind back to this Bolton scene we see, with Ramsay coming behind him with his normal, just plain, stone face, and then Ramsay getting some kind of news he disliked immensely. I feel like this is a face of almost betrayal, like he could be saying that his heir has been born, and he's going to disown him, he won't get the Dreadfall or something like that, and then Ramsay's going to act up from that. Now, if my hunch is right and they're going to have conflict between Ramsay and Roose Bolton this season, then the person who's flaming their flayed could be someone completely different than we originally thought. Now, we come back to Melisandre kind of confiding with Davos again, which I thought she would do. They're going to kind of grow closer, even though they had their differences and they had this connection. He's not going to trust her or like her at first, but this relationship will be built up over time. Also, the situation and the urgency of Jon Snow's death and the things that are happening will force them to accelerate this process. Also, I must mention this quick little scene here where they have the guy smashing down the door. I believe this is in Castle Black, and I think that Davos and Melisandre might be in that room currently after chasing off the Black Brothers and reviving Jon Snow. And by the time they get in there, Jon Snow will be awake and alive, and they'll be all too flabbergasted to do anything about it. But that's speculating quite a bit there. Now, staying in the north, we seem to have Brienne fighting some person who could be a Bolton soldier. So I believe that she might be still involved with Sansa's storyline, and they might reconnect, and she will accept Brienne's help at this point. And then finally, she'll actually do something useful for once. Speaking of Sansa, we have this quick little scene here of her with like this fur coat that could be like a wolf pelt or something like that around her soldier. She's all made up and stuff. She doesn't look like destroyed and distraught like she did in those photos that we got. She looks all lordly, like ladylike. So maybe she's made it to one of the Northern Lords. She's starting to play the Game of Thrones like we got from that Tyrion overlap narration where he said,
"You're in the great game now. And the great game is terrifying."
Quick note, does anyone else think that could be Cold Hands or Bitchenstark? Because that would be really awesome. Now before we rush ourselves too much, we have to talk about this giant battle scene that's going on. It's clearly going to be involving some of the Bolton armies, as we could see from this giant roll of Bolton shields. Now I'm not entirely sure if it's going to be Sansa or Jon Snow who gathers this army and brings it to Winterfell, but I have the feeling that maybe Sansa will play the Game of Thrones, go to the Northern Lords, raise the army, get the North to rebel and join behind her. And then once Sansa's done all this work in binding the North together, Jon Snow's going to reveal himself as alive and help out Sansa, and together they will try to take down the Boltons. The true revenge of the Starks will truly come when the hammer of the two most unlikely siblings working together will destroy them. Okay, now I'm going to go through all the little battle snippets and see if we can point out anything that leads us to any new information that we don't know yet. Now this first one here, we have these horses charging with people. I don't see any banners or any Stark armors like that, so it could be opposing force, but they don't seem to be riding in snow, so this could be a smaller battle or a big battle before this point of this huge snow battle outside Winterfell. Here we can see the Bolton flag and a whole long of archers, so that's probably the Bolton army firing their arrows into the Stark army. But that's stating it pretty obvious. Now here we see Theon kind of trapped by what seems to be Bolton soldiers and their dogs. So I feel like they've been caught up by Bolton soldiers, and Theon may have sacrificed himself and stayed behind or led off different trails so Sansa could get away to the north. So we have Tormund looking like he's been caught out kind of thing. He's in trouble, and there's been those same Bolton shields there. So he's from the same fight with the other Bolton shields we saw before. Now these shields coming from the other side, so I feel like they might have been surrounded, and this fight is not the major north fight that we've been seeing in the past. This could be like a smaller skirmish between the wildlings led by some people versus the Boltons, and not the giant fight of the north. This could be the same fight where we saw the horses running, because it's not snowy and it's more muddy. Now we can see this battle where the horses have fallen over and done this whole explosion of dirt, and right here people believe that that is Jon Snow riding in behind them. So clearly Jon Snow has to be part of one of these fight scenes at least. We also have another shot of wildlings and Tormund fighting to the bitter end for their lives. Now from that little teaser we saw from Tormund when he posted that thing about him shaving his beard and cut off one little thing, I really hope that means that he's not going to die this season, but we don't know. Okay, now we're going to move on to the King's Landing storyline. Now we can see that Jaime's ship has returned to King's Landing with the bad news that Missella has died. Now if you thought that Cersei was crazy before, once she finds this out, she's going to go completely mental. Now we have the scene of Jaime confiding in Cersei, trying to comfort her from her craziness by saying that we're the only ones that matter and we'll take back everything that was taken plus more. Now Jaime fans are going to have to prepare themselves, because I feel like he's going to relapse back to his old child murdering self. With Cersei's huge problems and dementia and craziness is going to stack up on him, and he's going to be forced into a pressure situation to do more rash things, and that's going to lead him to a really dark path. Now clearly Cersei and Jaime are going to have a handful trying to deal with the Faith. Now if you thought the Faith was aggressive and going out at it last season, this season is going to be stepping it up hugely. Now I really like the scene where Lance Lannister comes in and he says,
"Order your man to step aside or there will be violence."
"I choose violence."
This scene clearly reflects the mindset of the Faith, the mindset of Cersei, and the way that the characters are portrayed. Now Cersei is fully ready to lash back with her lioness wrath, There's going to be a lot of confrontation between the Faith and the Gold Cloaks, the Lannister forces in King's Landing. There's going to be quite a few skirmishes over different things like that, but I feel like this is going to boil down to one trial by contact with Robert Strong. Also, I must note that silence they had with Robert Strong, they had like the music playing and the dialogue, and they had this perfect little gap of complete silence when we had that roll pass panning shot of Robert Strong, which was very good for his character because he's completely silent. Now, the way they structure these two shots where they have Tommen walking in and they have Cersei walking in the opposite direction, they have these glares on their face like stone hard. I feel like Tommen's going to have to bring out his character a lot and not just be a mama's boy anymore. Glad to see they didn't forget about Margaery. She's going to be a very important player this season. Now we have Jaime relapsing again. Now this little scene here when they have the man jumping out a bit crazy into some open area is very clearly representing the radicalist ways that they're going to start, you know, attacking the city, that the people of the city are just not going to accept the ways that things were before until change happens. The peasants are going to be loud, they're going to be obnoxious, they're going to be self-destructive, they're going to be painful, and they're going to be crazy. Now, I can't be certain, but I believe that maybe Margaery, like, getting, you know, relief from the High Sept in exchange for something like that. And she's like, I'll let you be free if you do this, or you go against the Lannisters, or you get your house to do some shit. Or it could be another influential character that we don't know about yet. Right here, we have that mob mentality again with a whole bunch of people smashing down. It doesn't matter how strong you are, if they just overwhelm you with tons of them just beating their sore and bloodied hands on you, you're gonna die eventually. Okay, this is when the Tyrells finally arrive, and they're clearly here to make their claim and say, yo, we're not okay with Margaery being here. I believe the High Septon has just come out from talking to Margaery before. He's going to walk down those steps, go talk to the leader and say, we're going to release her and stuff like that, and calm the whole situation down. So a Lannister army in King's Landing is not a good thing for Cersei, especially once they release Margaery and their focus turns from the Faith to the Lannisters. Okay, now we flip all the way over to the Narrow Sea with the Daenerys storyline. Now we start off with Dario and Jorah tracking her and finding this ring on the ground. They're going across the Dothraki Sea trying to find out where she is and rescue her. Then they cut across the scene of Daenerys and she's walking among the Horde. She's walking on the ground at the same level as slaves. Her hands are binded and she's going into Vaes Dothrak. I must say, I really like the way that the lighting is done, is that they have this like hoof shoe, so you know that she's going to Vaes Dothrak. There's this giant hall with tons and tons of people. There's no way you could normally point her out, but then she's like this beam of light hitting on her blonde white hair, and you just see her there, it's like standing out so clearly. Now there's two things about this next part where we see her looking up, okay? This is her realizing she's going to Vaes Dothrak, and she's probably been kept in the dark this entire time of where she's going and what she's doing. Now she's realized she's going to go with all the other Khaleesis that have lost their husbands and joined the Crows. We also have the second thing of the High Sparrow doing that dialogue saying,
every one of us is poor and powerless, yet we can overthrow an empire.
This is the big indicator that she comes into the storyline, the very start of the season, extremely low, squashed down, she's on slave level, she's been captured, she's heading to Vaes Dothrak for a boring life with these people that she really didn't want to join ever in her entire life. She's afraid of them even when she was a young youthful and her cowboys are well alive. But then they're talking about how even though people can be powerless and have no wealth, she can rise up with and destroy this huge empire. So that could be an indication that she's going to be able to convince all of these Dothraki to join her and change the world. Now also we have Tyrion playing the game and having to deal with the Harpy and stuff like that. So clearly he's in a bad situation. He's had to go through quite a few challenges managing to hold the city together. Also the shot here where they have the dragon flapping its wing for a brief second. It's kind of like the brief little snippet of hope that the dragons can still help them out. Okay, right here we have the window doors of what seem to be the old apartments of Daenerys getting busted open by some kind of wind force. It could be like the dragon or a catapult shot or the harpies doing some shit. So even way up in this pyramid, things aren't safe. Now quickly before we go to the Greyjoys and a few of the flashbacks and things we can see in here, I'm going to cover a few of Arya's little scenes. Now here when she's getting slapped and like smacked in the face, that's part of her training from the House of Black and White, I believe. So I think they're going to go through quite a lot of different scenes where like she's blind and where she loses her hair and like where she gets smacked like that. So her training is going to be stepped up to a new level and hopefully she can get quite a lot through that before things start to change. Other than that scene of all the faces and stuff like that, which we've already seen in a previous like teaser, there wasn't much else they gave us of a storyline, but from that teaser that we saw, I feel like the morals and the whole philosophical thing is going to be very heavily jammed into her storyline. Now right there we can see that the flags have the Kraken of the Greyjoys, and we have this giant gathering of men which could be the Kingsmoot. I'm pretty sure that Balon Greyjoy is going to die really quickly in the beginning of the season, and then Euron Greyjoy is going to come in and become a big part of the season. We can see there that there's the man in white who was the religious leader of the Drowned God, and he's going to be there just to make sure that the person who is anointed by the Kingsmoot is clearly put into through the ritual rules. Okay, we have these boats, which I believe could be Greyjoy boats, because they're the most ones associated with boats in the sea and stuff. So they could be heading out to either like go to Daenerys like they did in the books and stuff like that, or a whole bunch of other things. Right here we have someone from the Islands getting a ceremonial drowning in that pot of water, which is what they're supposed to do, become like their manhood or be anointed or something like that. That could be Euron Greyjoy himself, because the way they had the previous scene with Theon quickly turning his head in surprise, which is kind of a good mashing of clips there. Now I'm not entirely sure, but I believe that she might be Asha, and that could be a very interesting part of the storyline. So if that's right, then I believe that Asha is still going to have a very key part to play, like she does in the books with the King Moot, with the succession. She's going to try and fight for her own rights. Don't think I don't see you, Game of Thrones, chucking that current event thing right there. Okay, let's cover some of the smaller little scenes we get from like flashback and things like that, and we'll see what we can figure out from them. The first one we get is this one here when we have what I believe is young Ned Stark heading to the Tower of Joy, but to that fight scene against the three Knights of the King's Guard. Again here we can clearly see that they've got the Targaryen symbol on the chest of the armor, so it's going to be way back in the Civil War, and it's going to be that flashback. Now I'm not certain why he is not in like white armor. It could be like some previous fighting of Targaryens where it's not the Kingsguard people with the Tower of Joy first, but that should be an interesting new plot twist they add in. Now to me it'd be very interesting to see if they use this flashback to reveal Jon Snow's past, because if he's going to be revived back to life, we know it's super important. We're going to be revealing a whole bunch of stuff. We know that the show will be lying to us, and so they're going to be a very incredible twist. So if we can find out his past, his parentage, and he comes back to life, it's going to be a really big season for Game of Thrones. Okay, I know this entire time I've been holding off this last scene just for you guys, because this is immense. Bran is standing there right next to the White Walker leader. Now, as I discussed previously with those promo picture, I believe that Bran is not truly standing up, but he's kind of like a visionary form. So this right here is him communicating with the White Walkers. So this is here where I believe we're going to find out their side of the story, which would be so cool. This is going to be the biggest plot twist change in the entire series. I feel like the White Walkers have been misunderstood, and their intentions and motivations have been hidden in like a shrine that we have not known yet. The show is going to use Bran as the mediator to find out what the White Walkers are doing, what the side they are, and to show the misunderstanding between the characters that will lead to the final end plot point. Or they could be complete dicks and end the season right before where they're about to tell us the most important information, which they might actually do. Okay guys, there's a lot of information in this trailer, like so much information, so I may have missed some things. If I have, then put it down in the comment section below, we can start a dialogue there and we can talk about things we believe that's going to lead to. Also, if you have any other questions that you want, I might do a Q&A video or something along those lines over the huge amount of trailers we've got. We've got like a whole bunch of teaser trailers, we've got this big drop now, we've got those promo pictures. If you have any questions from any of that stuff, things that you want me to explain about season 6 or from the books or that, then write those questions to me in the comment section below on my Twitter or something like that, and I might answer those in a video or just reply to you if there's not enough. Okay guys, I'm super hyped for season 6 of Game of Thrones. I know you are too, so I won't hold you for too long. If you guys want to rewatch this trailer a billion times like I have, then it's gonna be great. I'll see you guys next time. Oh, by the way, check out my Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube channel. Subscribe now for awesomeness.